Okay, so thank you all for being here. We are so excited to welcome you to the Symposium on Surveillance and Education. I just wanted to welcome you on behalf of the four groups that we have represented here that have been collaboratively working on this event. The first is the Othering and Belonging Institute. The second is the Algorithmic Fairness and Opacity Group. The third is the D-Lab. And the fourth is Cal Nerds. We've all been working together to put on this symposium. And it's been a really great experience trying to put this together and get amazing speakers. And we're very just excited to have this today. The collaborations that we've had, I think, are really unique. We are very different sorts of institutions and groups on the UC Berkeley campus. We're coming at things from slightly different perspectives, and I think that has allowed us to have a program that is really rich and exciting. So we hope that that will be reflected in the conversations we have today, and we're so thankful to have you as part of the conversations as well. Just real quick, if you are willing to type in the chat, just where you're zooming in from. The one big thing here that's great is that people can be participating from all over the country and the world. So if you are willing to tell us where you're zooming in from, that's great. I can tell you I'm here on the UC Berkeley campus. Welcome from Berkeley. All right, we're gonna have lots of Berkeleys. Lots of Bay Area too. Oh, okay. Awesome. So yeah, thanks. And feel free if you want to continue. I'm also just going to tell you real quick about our Fiat Justice Scholars Program, which is the big impetus for putting this program together. We kind of came upon the idea of collaborating because we've been running this program for undergraduate students at UC Berkeley called the Fiat Justice Scholars Program. The program is designed for undergraduate students who are excited and engaged with public interest technologies and social justice, tech equity, to try to get into that space, both in terms of research and in terms of careers. We've put on a lot of programming through the course of the year, and I'm the postdoc who's been working with the Fiat Justice Scholars Program. And so when we came to everybody who's been working as part of this collaboration for the symposium, we were asking, what are some ways we could work together to provide great programming for the Fiat Justice Scholars? And I think this obviously serves as great programming for our Fiat Justice program, but I also think it serves as an excellent event well beyond the parameters of just our program. And so again, that's, I think, what these collaborations can offer. And I'm actually going to go ahead and pass the mic off to one of the collaborators who is here, I guess, on behalf of and representing the Othering and Belonging Institute. And so please welcome Emmett.
Thanks, Jeremy. Hey, everyone. Good morning. Good afternoon. I think mainly good morning. It seems like a lot of Bay Area folks. Thanks for being here. Like Jeremy said, I'm one of the collaborators on this event, and I'm coming from the Othering and Belonging Institute, also affiliated with UC Berkeley. I'm a research and policy analyst on the team there. My work mainly focuses on corporate power and pathways to community power building in different forums. So in the economy and government and the workplace and beyond, and kind of thinking about our work in relation to technology is relatively new, but a really exciting part of our journey to thinking about othering and belonging. So we've been examining through narrative research, through a lot of partnerships work, both the promises and threats of advanced technologies, and also digging into the political economy in which technology operates. So we're an interdisciplinary institute ourselves, and so we're really excited to be in partnership with this team of critical technologists at the iSchool, AFOG, CalNerds, D-Lab. So thanks so much for joining us, and to the folks on the planning team for being open to the collaboration. I think we'll also give you a bit of a sense of what to expect for the rest of the morning and the afternoon. So if you looked when you registered on the website, we have three great sessions for you. So right after this introduction, we're going to kick off with our very first panel on kind of the educational changes that surveillance technologies or learning technologies have brought to the classroom, both virtual and perhaps in other forms on campus. That will then be followed by a breakout group. So we want to really give a chance for people from whichever different topic or level of information you're coming at this issue with, you can have time to exchange ideas with other participants, reflect on what you heard from the speakers. So we'll have that after our 10 a.m. panel, as well as after our 11:30 panel later in the morning. Those will be breakout groups. And we also have a space where you can kind of have write down your notes, do collaboration, maybe exchange contact information. We really hope that you get a chance to engage and learn from each other in this time. And then after a short break for lunch, we'll come back around 1 to do some visioning. So we're gonna get into some big topics around how technology has changed our experience with education, how it interacts with other systems in both a higher education and a K through 12 setting. So we want to give you a space to kind of explore visioning and new futures as you dig into those ideas and articulate how we might come up with different technologies or different community building exercises between educators and students or between administrators and students and all across the spectrum of people who are involved in education. So that's what we have coming forward for you today. I think we'll also want to hit on a couple quick digital housekeeping things. I think everyone's already done this, but if you can keep mics muted during the panels, that would be appreciated. We will invite you to use the chat box to reflect, plus one, add different things, ideas, questions. We're going to make an effort to have some time for questions at the end of each panel. So please do throw those in the chat as they come to you. Like I said, we'll drop the link to a collaborative space that you can add notes when you're in your breakout groups. If you have to drop in and out, like I said, we have a couple different sessions today. You can use this very same Zoom link. That's no worries at all. If you have questions on something logistical in the chat, you should see that a couple of us are listed as co-host, and you can feel free to reach out to any of us. So thank you again. We're really excited to get started, and I'll pass it back to Jeremy.
Thank you. The other thing that we want to do right before we get panel one started is just welcome our planning committee to introduce themselves really quick. I just want to make sure that everybody knows. Sorry, I'm springing that on you. We forgot to mention that. But I just want to make sure that we recognize everybody who's been working on planning this symposium right from the start here. We've got an extra minute to do that. And so I'm going to go ahead and pass it to Hikari.
I guess I'll say really quickly, I'm Hikari, I use she, her pronouns. I've been helping out with this effort. I'm a PhD student in the Energy and Resources group, and I'm a fellow at the D-Lab. So it's nice working with the whole group.
Ksenia?
Hello, my name is Ksenia. I'm a fifth year math student at UC Berkeley. I am representing CalNerds here, and I'm happy to be here today.
Richmond?
Hi, I'm Richmond. I'm a postdoc at the Berkeley Center for Long-Term Cybersecurity and a AFOG member.
And Deirdre?
Hi, I'm Deirdre Mulligan. I'm a professor at the School of Information, she, her pronouns, and I'm just delighted at how we collaboratively put this program together. And I'm super excited to listen to all of you and hopefully to reimagine our future.
Awesome. Well, thanks everybody for introducing yourselves. And this again has been really wonderful collaboration. So we're gonna go ahead and transition into the first panel. I am going to spotlight some speakers here. Been a little bit since I've done the pinning. There we go. Okay, and I guess I should pin myself, but I'm not showing up. There we go. Okay. Is everybody seeing the four of us together? Just want to make sure that's looking right to everybody. Cool. All right. Awesome. So I want to welcome everybody to our first panel, which has to do with the educational changes that have come in terms of surveillance and education. And I think especially reflecting on the last couple of years during the COVID-19 pandemic, obviously many things have been in motion since well before that. But over the last couple of years, I think we've seen a real intensification of conversations about education and surveillance, the ed tech tools that we can use in the classroom and in administering our universities, our campuses. And I think that there have been a lot of controversial topics. There have been a lot of contestations and frustrations. And I think that the representation we have on the panel of people coming from different backgrounds in relationship to technologies in the classroom and on campus will reflect how different stakes are represented in all of this, and how there is a lot of room for us to collaborate and work together on having educational technologies serve us effectively and serve everyone effectively in classrooms and on campuses. And so the theme for this panel is to understand how the development of educational tech tools, especially the surveillance tools that we've had, has reshaped the relationships among faculty, staff, students, and administrators. Again, I think that the composition of our panel will speak to that, those relationships and those differences that have come about. And so the first thing that I just want to do really quickly is ask everybody on the panel to introduce themselves, just so we have a sense of who we're talking with. And then I'll go ahead and ask the first question that we have. And I should say, if we could start with Scott.
Thank you, Jeremy. I want to thank the symposium planners for inviting me and inviting all of us. This is an exciting topic. I'm really excited that you are thinking about surveillance and not just accepting it. So I'm Scott Seaborn. I use the he, series pronouns. I'm the campus privacy officer here at UC Berkeley.
Thank you. Elana?
Hi, I'm Elana Zeide. I'm an assistant professor at the University of Nebraska College of Law, where I research a lot of education privacy things. I'm very excited to be here as well. My pronouns are she, her, and I can't wait to get started.
And?
Hi, everyone. I'm Anna. I'm a third year here at UC Berkeley. My pronouns are she, her. Thank you for organizing all of this, and thank you for having student voices being heard and represented. I appreciate that.
Yeah, thank you all so much. And then we wanted to go ahead and get started with kind of a broad question, which is to ask what, in your view, is the most important or central educational technology tool that has been taken up since the start of the pandemic, or the usage has grown significantly since the start of the pandemic. Feel free to expound on why you think that tool maybe has become popular and what it might offer for faculty, administrators, students, staff. And so I'll go ahead and pass it to whoever is interested in getting us started.
Sure. I will say the technology we are using right now is probably the most prominent with the pandemic, Zoom. You know, I think Zoom is also a really interesting example of education technology, because it's not technically education technology, right? That's not why it was particularly developed. At the very beginning of the pandemic, they had a lot of trouble because they hadn't considered really educational use. They were just an enterprise software tool that hadn't considered both student privacy issues, but also, you know, the dynamic in student with student and education technology, which is you often have students who are trying to mess up the technology, you know, who are trying to play with the technology, hack it, sometimes a way, sometimes in not a playful way, but they just really weren't prepared. But I think, you know, here we are now.
Yeah, I would echo that. I was going to say Zoom, and then the corresponding technologies like Kaltura, which we use here, that are used to capture recordings of Zoom lectures and classroom discussions, and then allow faculty to post them or include them in a learning management system. The other one I was going to say was learning management system itself. There were a lot of efforts before the pandemic to use learning management systems for analytical purposes to evaluate students in a separate manner aside from grades and assignments. And I think that technology has really grown in the couple of years that we've been in the pandemic, and how people use it and the desired use cases have really grown exponentially. People are trying to figure out how students are engaged with their classes, and not just in the lecture itself or in a classroom discussion, but are they clicking on links? Are they reading the assignments? And those kinds of analytics are great in terms of measuring student engagement, but there are some privacy concerns as well. So I would say those two sets of technologies have been really important.
Yeah, I was going to say Zoom as well, especially for students. That's realistically the only way for us to participate in the university when we were online for COVID. So not only for like this academic setting, but also social. Like I had a lot of club meetings and everything over Zoom. And it also provides a lot of flexibility, which also does come with the pressure of being online because it's so available. But definitely like the flexibility of having Zoom meetings be recorded, or you could be out of town as we have people out of town here. So good and bad, but it's also kind of like the only thing we have. So that makes it interesting.
All right, well, it seems like there's some consensus, and here we are using that tool, of course. I was wondering if in terms of Zoom as a follow-up, but also broadly in terms of surveillance, what would you see as some of the most important issues about surveillance and privacy in terms of Zoom or in terms of any of the other ed tech tools and surveillance that we might talk about? Sorry, I'll just, I realized I got a little roundabout there. In terms of privacy and surveillance and security for faculty, staff, and students, what have been some major changes since the start of the pandemic, maybe in particular with Zoom or other technologies that you would imagine?
Which one of us? Okay, I'll go ahead, sorry. I'd say just the almost normalization of being recorded. It's very normal to like, be recorded, and there might be people who are not comfortable with that, but I don't think Zoom yet has a thing where you're required to actively consent to be recorded through the Zoom. I've seen it in certain Zoom rooms where you have to click okay and then you can enter the room. And I think also being a student, sometimes you're not really given the option of being recorded. It's just like happening because of the fact that there's students that can't make it on real time on Zoom. And so it's kind of like in order to help other students, some students may feel uncomfortable being recorded and then kind of creates a sticky situation.
I think this surveillance with that, you know, Zoom, it's obvious, right? You're being recorded. I also think there's, at least at the beginning of the pandemic or some portion of it, some more, you know, geographic location health tracking with things like contacts you know, university that have, you had to get tested. And if you had a green light basically on your app, you were allowed in the building. You know, that's something that is new, right? But also I think to what Scott was saying is there's a lot of new tools professors are using, especially learning management systems, but a lot of different tools are used now. And so now professors have access to information. And, you know, as you were saying, some of that information can be fantastic. Some of it's completely useless. And some of it seems like it might be accurate, but you know, if I look at some of my Canvas metrics, it's like this student clicked on this page 1,000 times. That is unlikely. Right? That is unlikely. So, I mean, I'm interesting, but I'm not that interesting. So it's like, you know, I think part of it is professors now have a lot of access to analytics that are promising in some ways, are invasive in some other ways, and can be very misleading if people don't understand what they're looking at.
Yeah, I would agree with that. And thinking about Zoom in particular, this has really brought up issues of privacy. Obviously, we're in different spaces when we're on Zoom. We can be in our homes. We can be out in public sometimes, especially students if they're, you know, working or doing other things. So it's really brought a personal space and personal privacy as a discussion topic. And it hasn't always gone well. I'll just say that in some cases, their faculty members have required, for example, that students have their cameras on, and these are classes that are being recorded. So I find that as problematic, especially depending on their living situation and where they've been during the pandemic. And then the other thing I was going to bring up has to do with monitoring to prevent cheating or to evaluate if someone's cheating. So online proctoring tools that can be very invasive and intrusive into someone's privacy, into their personal space, into their computer. Some of these tools have not really been evaluated for bias. So that's an area where I think just the need to evaluate students and to grade students in a remote situation was so prevalent that I think in some cases, you know, some schools probably look the other way in terms of privacy.
Thank you. And so when we think about surveillance and privacy and the power that is positioned within these technologies and tools, I want to ask what structures and frameworks and institutional policies are in place to ensure adequate privacy, security, and rights for the students, for the people using these technologies, for the people who are affected by the surveillance tech. And again, this could be in terms of legal frameworks, this could be in terms of institutional policies or other possible structures. What protections are there in place and are they adequate?
I can answer part of this anyway. There are legal protections like the Family Educational Rights and Privacy Act, FERPA, that protects student data and in many cases can prevent the inappropriate disclosure of student data. There are also policies at various campuses. The UC system has some privacy policies. But what we found during the pandemic anyway is that these policies and legal frameworks were not really designed for remote instruction. And they don't have the capability to ensure that student privacy is protected in every situation. So under FERPA, there is an exception to the consent requirement for what's called legitimate educational interests. So if the school official or the department feels that a disclosure of student data is appropriate in the sense that it promotes legitimate educational interests, that disclosure is okay under FERPA, even if the student doesn't consent. And if you're using video recording technology, you're sharing, you're posting student data, even publicly, the argument can be made that, oh, you're just trying to make this information so you couldn't attend a lecture, things like that. But it gets into a real gray area. So I think the regulatory and legal frameworks are going to have to catch up to some of the technology changes that have occurred in the past, 5 to 10 years, especially in the pandemic. And campus policies are going to have to catch up as well.
So you mentioned my favorite thing, FERPA, so thank you. In terms of framework, so I think it's important to look at three different areas when we think about what the governance structures might be. One is technical, what technical barriers can we put into place? One is institutional, what the institutions can do to create some, and then there's of course the legal areas. And as Scott was saying, most student privacy laws are designed to prevent unauthorized disclosure or access to information. They're not designed to do anything when a school has approved a technology and are using it for educational purposes. And this creates a real problem, which I think we saw with the online proctoring tools in particular, that there is nothing to protect students against surveillance from their educational institution, from the vendors they use. And as long as it's educational, which it's very, the bar for legitimate educational interests, it's almost self-definitional, right? So if the school says it's educational, it is. So, there's really, the structure is lacking there. And in terms of institutional, I think it so much depends on your institution. So the California system had a task force several years ago where they thought about student privacy. They thought about appropriate use of data. Most school systems haven't and don't really have the resources or the sophistication in order to do so. So, one thing that's problematic is you put into place not just things that are surveying, but things that are making decisions, often algorithmic decisions, behind the black box. And so particularly with online proctoring, there's not typically an accountability system sent to place or a contestability situation. system. So both teachers and students are left with a situation where things are confusing, things are stressful, and often there's no real due process.
Yeah, that kind of, sorry, Scott, were you gonna say something?
No, go ahead.
Yeah, just quickly, like that kind of goes along with what I was gonna say, which is that I'm honestly not too aware of these structures. There's like FERPA that I know of, but especially from like the student side of it, we don't discuss this often, and it kind of is just like you use what you're given. And I would say a lot of it comes down to individuals making decisions to choose to protect like student privacy or the privacy of people that they're interacting with. For example, a professor choosing not to proctor specifically for privacy reasons, or a professor choosing to say cameras are optional because I understand that your home situations may be different and you have different ways of feeling secure in your learning. So that's what I've noticed is most helpful when it comes to these like protecting these values, is having someone in more of a position of power to actively say, I want to like protect your privacy and make sure you're comfortable in this space.
Yeah, I think that's really important. One thing we've tried to do here is to create a privacy balancing framework. So if faculty members are interested in a certain technology, the privacy office, legal, some other offices can review that technology from not just a regulatory standpoint or, you know, are we doing this? Are we going to break the law? But does this technology invade privacy? Does it provide transparency about how data is being used? Can students consent, or are they provided with choices around how their data is going to be used? So the good news is we are creating frameworks like that and privacy balancing tools. The bad news is that faculty are sometimes making purchases or doing things that aren't going through a central review process. So that's something we're working on as well.
Thank you. I'm just curious if anybody has any perspectives beyond the specific Berkeley instantiation that you just talked about, perhaps either through K-12 or through other institutions. Are these kinds of structures and safeguards in place elsewhere? I mean, obviously, in many cases, students don't even know about them here, about what that might be doing. And maybe a lot isn't available to students. Is that, are we doing better at Berkeley than other places, I guess, is what I'm wondering.
I won't make Scott answer that question himself, but I would say you're probably one of the best in the entire country, if not the world, about this. Partly because you have lots of institutions, like some of the ones sponsoring this event, that are there to inform the conversation inside the university. But, higher education institutions are much better than K-12 institutions, beyond a doubt. And where you are really makes a difference. So I should plug myself. So I have an article that's coming out actually any week at this moment called Big Proctor, that is about exactly this. It's about online proctoring systems and the problems technically, institutionally, and sort of legally, and what one might do about it. And I have some FERPA tricks. So if you're a FERPA nerd out there, go look at it. But in any case, in most situations, there's only some research being systematic research being surfacing now, but things were implemented without any thoughtfulness, without any training. You had lots of examples of teachers looking at information and not understanding what was coming from the reports of vendors, right? And vendors punting the responsibility because all the proctoring tools, the vendors say, we don't make the decision about cheating. We just tell you what might be cheating. And so, and then that goes to the and they say, we trust you educators are going to look over it, right? But some researchers come out and says, it could take like 9 hours to review one test. No teacher has that time, right? So it's just a bit of a cross your fingers and hope it's okay, which isn't really at all inadequate in a place where people might get into serious trouble for things. But, on the K-12 level, very few places have, it's like the IT person who might be doing this in like the 15 minutes at the end of the week, right? It's not, you don't have a dedicated person to doing it. So it's not entirely an institution's fault, but it's also is their responsibility.
I'll just add briefly, like my experience with high school, I used Chromebooks all through high school. Like no textbook is very like technology forward school. And there was never any discussion of privacy or security. Like obviously less invasive. There wasn't any cameras or like online class going on, but it is different to see like the fact that there's so many discussions going on within like higher education institutions, while like in high school, I never even received a talk from anybody about privacy and security on your Chromebooks and your laptops.
Yeah, I'll just mention that from my own experience as a parent, the kids are given, or not even given, they're told to use certain technologies that are provided by commercial vendors. And the commercial vendors do things like send targeted emails and things like that. And that's the kind of thing that, you know, if that was happening here in higher ed, and it does happen in higher ed, we would be concerned about. But it seems like nobody's talking about that in the K through 12 environment. And they're, you know, they're marketing to the kids, they're sending advertisements. The kids want to use these products that are somewhat educational, but are veering into like video games. And it's really not discussed at all. And we've talked to our district about that and have really gotten nowhere. So I think it's definitely an issue that needs to be raised in the K through 12 environment.
And I think in K through 12, you have there's always, when you deal with children and privacy, there's the flip side, which is the stranger danger and scary, right? So it's very easy to impose things out of for children's safety, you know, from their peers for bullying, from themselves for self-harm, from a violent shooter, from a evil stranger, right? And I think those tools are being put into place to monitor students, K-12 students, not just, you know, on their devices in home or at school, but also, for example, in social media. A lot of schools monitor, some schools monitor their students' social media, you know, to detect suspicious language or, you know, troublesome language, let's say.
So I'm interested in hearing your takes then, everybody's takes, on the notion of what students and people who are subjected to these surveillance structures could do. What actions are there? Like, what recourses? So if there are these sort of unjust uses or questionable uses, what can students do? I do just want to, two things real quick. Feel free, the audience, please put any questions in the chat. I see Deirdre put a question in the chat, but here at the end, I also like a couple questions to continue asking. So please put those in there. And yes, please stay tuned for the more on the K-12 at 11:30. So I'll just repeat, what actions, what recourse do students and people subjected to the structures have?
Scott, do you want to talk about internally and I can talk about more,
sure,
more generally?
Yeah, I mean, here at UC Berkeley, I would say the first thing is to say something. If you're in a classroom and you're being asked to turn your camera on and you don't want to, or you're using a technology that is recommended or required by your class or their instructor, and it's asking for personal information, for example, or it's asking you to consent to something that seems a little fishy, you can reach out to us. I'll put, the privacy inbox, the privacy office in the chat. Please reach out. We do have a process for adjudicating some of these things, and we can't always do something, but we can at least raise awareness among the faculty members that this is happening and that this is something that we need to think about. So I'd say that's the first step. From an institutional standpoint, we're trying to formalize some of these reviews and create a communication and notification process. So when a faculty member is interested in technology, we're trying to make it very easy for them to use a checklist or even reach out to the various offices on campus that will conduct a review, so that the process itself is not slowing up their use of technology, or not slowing it up too much. I know that's been a complaint. So that's something we're working on the institutional side, and then building awareness among the faculty. Deirdre's team, the Academic Senate Committee, the CIT Committee, has been extremely helpful in getting the word out and in helping us help faculty members review things from a privacy standpoint.
I agree that some of it is just education, both of students and of the professors, about their options, about the impact. And I think one of the most important things, but difficult things that can be done is, you know, in terms of some of the surveillance, trusting students more or giving them assignments that are not as amenable to cheating, right? So it's harder to grade, right? And it's harder to make meaningful assessments like a project, something like that. But, you know, in law school in particular, there's lots of open book exams, right? That less, you know, you can pedagogically, it's better to do not as much sort of, you know, memorization tests. And one thing is to have you know, have teachers structure their classes and their assessment so that you don't need as much surveillance to make sure that the students are doing what they should be doing. There is a lot of talk about changes that happens and then often nothing ends up resulting. There may be some movement, I think, on children's privacy in the near future. But so I'm going to give you guys, this is like a scoop, okay, as far as that goes in student privacy. But something you can do is in this paper, I'm putting forth an idea that you may be able to use, sorry, Scott, you might not like this, you may be able to use your FERPA rights to gain access to your records, not only your records that the university might have about you, but the records that the your vendor may have about you. So get into the details of why the proctoring company thinks that you need it. I have an argument saying that they should actually be giving you enough that you can access and contest it. That is a right you have under FERPA to contest the accuracy of information in your record. Sorry, Scott. Yeah, sorry, Scott, if everyone, people do
no,
that.
No, this is great. It's going to be more work, but it's good work.
But that said, aside from some legal tools, like that's a little sneaky legal tool, but you know, you'll see if it gets traction, right? But also a lot of it is speaking up. Some schools are responsive, at least, to students' voices and protests. They aren't all, right? But it is a way to do it. But when you do it, it's really important to be aware of the facts on the ground. So with online proctoring, there was a lot of rhetoric early on where people were outraged. And they were right to be outraged in many cases. But some of the thrust of and the force of their arguments didn't have as much power. Because they're kind of copying and pasting things, what they were saying, or evidence, and they were just saying, this sucks, and cool, it sucks is not a bad thing to say, but, you know, it helps to be strategic with that protest if you can. But I don't have a great, perfect, hardcore solution at this stage.
Mentioning like transparency in records, that's something I was thinking about is when it comes to student data, and also I'm sure like faculty data and all of that, is that I think oftentimes you just don't know what's happening with it. I filled out so many surveys that I've gotten from College of Letters and Sciences, from other places within Berkeley, and I don't really know what they did with that. They don't really say like what the research was about, who's leading it. So a bit more like transparency about that, and also maybe starting off with like educating faculty on this as well, because I would say the majority of students aren't going to go to like a privacy office to learn about this. They're gonna maybe just randomly, for some reason, it comes up in a class and they ask their professor a question about like, oh, do you know where this data goes? And that tends to be like where they go first. And then from there, if the professor doesn't know, they kind of just let it go and move on with their day. And I was just thinking about that because I was on a research team that did predictive analytics for College of Letters and Sciences. And we sent out a survey, like kind of saying what we're trying to do. And I was on the team and I don't even know where it's lingering somewhere like in the files of Berkeley online. Like, I don't really know what happened to it. And I think there's just a lot of ways that we could probably structure data and like put policies in place to understand where your data went and to be able to like contact people and see what's happening with it.
So I'm going to take some questions from the chat. And so far I see a couple questions from Deirdre. And so I think kind of following up on what we just started to talk about, from each of your perspectives, what changes do you think need to be made to protect students, to create, you know, trusting and effective relationships on our campuses, in our communities? What recommendations do you have from your experiences, from your research, from what you can envision in the future? What changes would you make?
One of the other panelists mentioned trust in students in creating assignments that you don't have to proctor for, just because it's really stressful and it's just kind of like scary and uncomfortable. And you're like, what if I filmed myself wrong during this online exam and now I'm going to fail the class? Like, it just gets overwhelming to deal with like normal workload and then also having to deal with like this proctoring. This does kind of start with like professors and individual faculty, but having them understand that like students aren't here to trick professors and stuff like that. Like, we're just trying to learn too. And that adds kind of this added stress. So yeah, starting with trust and creating these assignments that you don't have to film yourself with like three different cameras in order to turn it in.
So I would say part of that is one thing that can be done is to be transparent, as you were saying, but also for schools to have sufficient oversight mechanisms in place. So if something happens with you in a proctoring system and you do film yourself and something goes, you know, the system has an inappropriate alert, to know that there is something in place so that that will be caught, or that you will not get in trouble for that. So you won't be subject to unfair things. You can't make the technology perfect, right? But you could give students enough reassurance so that they're like, okay, something could go wrong. I shouldn't be sloppy about this, but it doesn't mean that my life is gonna be over because the vendor is gonna make sure it's okay on that end. And with that is one other thing, which is, I think to not adopt technologies that are not yet proven, right? So online proctoring technology is a really big one here. So some of the basis of online evidence supporting its accuracy, at least, and increasingly across, okay, there's problems across populations. We're not getting there today, but yeah, anyway. Give students enough reassurance that the tools you're using aren't going to go wrong and they're not going to be punished for it if they do go wrong.
Yeah, I agree with that 100%. One of the key concerns in privacy has to do with decisions that are made by algorithms or it's called automated decision making. So when a decision is made basically by a machine and there's no human review of that decision, and I think working with student conduct offices to make sure that the proctoring software's results, or there's cheating in this exam, for example, at face value, and there's a human review, there's a discussion with the student, and communicating that to students that there will be a chance for a human to look at this rather than just a decision made by a proctoring tool. And I don't know if that was communicated adequately during the pandemic in various schools. I will say that UC Berkeley, aside from one graduate program, we did not allow any proctoring tools, software using AI. We did allow Zoom, as Anna mentioned, there were some problems with that. Where students would record themselves on Zoom and there were some problems. So I think creating a policy that allows for human review and working with student conduct to implement that and communicating out to students is very important so that they're not, you know, going into an exam, freaking out about what if the AI software notices my eye twitching or something like that. They're just not going to worry. They can take the exam with a little more comfort, knowing that there will be a human reviewing it.
Yeah, thank you. We have just a minute, so I'm going to go ahead and ask one more question here. And I'm going to ask just kind of in terms of pedagogy and learning in classrooms. This is from Michael in the chat. What sorts of changes have happened in terms of pedagogy and learning, the outcomes, the structures, due to the surveillance and ed tech platforms that we have, kind of in terms of learning and pedagogy?
I've tried to teach definitely what I preach, right? So I've tried to put in measures that in place that are, I have students taking exams without proctors, right? And I am trusting them. And, you know, I'm trusting them, but I'm also creating a test where, you know, they have a lot of stuff to do. They're not gonna have time to like confer with their friends, right? They have a book they can look at. It's not about looking up the stuff in the book. But I do think that all the surveillance, including things like Zoom, you know, I do think it does have a chilling effect. I think people do get acclimated, for better or worse, to being recorded, doing things. But, you know, I don't, you know, once you see things like professors getting in trouble for saying something on their Zoom or something like that, I think students are quite reluctant anyway to say things that might be controversial, might be unpopular, that might be on, you know, what they perceive as an unpopular side of the political spectrum or whatever the classroom is. And I think that's really exacerbated when they know it's going to be recorded and that it could be somehow used out of context against them.
I think kind of the sense of how you said like that chilling effect. I've noticed that too, or Zoom, somehow it just like classes feel less comfortable because it's almost like you don't have that before and after time for small talk, for talking to your neighbor. And so it almost feels like what you have to say right now has to be really thought out, has to be really serious. And like you're being recorded a lot of the times too. And so it's just a bit more nerve wracking than a normal class. Like being one-on-one in breakout rooms or like communicating via chat where like some people potentially may not have asked a question in an in-person class because they didn't want to speak up, but now they can use chat. So I think, like I mentioned before, there's always good and bad.
Yeah, I know we don't have much time, but I'll just say that not all of the technological changes have been bad as a result of going remote. I'll give one example where the pandemic kind of spurred our technology folks to work on APN students secure VPN connection for students in China that is less subject to surveillance and can access certain things that the normal internet service in China cannot access. So there have been some positive changes that have come about as a result of the pandemic forcing us to look at these solutions.
Yeah, thanks for adding the positive there. I think that's really important to think about too, right? We often focus on the harmful impacts, and there have been many, but that's a great example. Well, thank you all for your remarks. I am going to now invite us to transition into breakout rooms.